Hi, this is my third and final video on the building process of the maskless wafer stepper. Now the first video was about the optics, the second was mostly on the mechanics, and in this video I will cover the electronics and software of the machine. Now videos on electronics and especially on software can quickly become really boring, and I actually had a hard time staying awake making this video. So I'll try to keep it as short and to the point as possible. And I don't expect many people to duplicate this project, but this video might contain some useful insights for people working on related projects. Okay, so let's start. Here's sort of a functional overview of the machine. There are three axes to control. For the actuation of the X and Y axis, I use servos, and for the Z stage, I use a piezo actuator. Now, the reason for using a piezo for the Z-axis is that I only need a small travel range and a very high accuracy. Now, there are two other things, and that is switching the light source on and off, and the other thing is that we need to send images from the PC to the projection system, which is a DLP beamer. So I came up with the following schematic for the electronics. The main controller is the PC with the software, and it sends the projection images to the high-definition beamer over a standard HDMI output. The projector is basically just configured as the second screen of the computer, and connecting it is trivial. It basically just involves connecting a second video cable. The computer software, which I will discuss later, also sends movement commands for the axes directly to a CNC controller card, which is the KFLOP from Dynomotion. Now this card is connected using a standard USB port. The KFLOP is actually sort of a super Arduino, and its intended applications are mainly in CNC. It's actually quite a versatile card, but to be able to really use it requires a pretty solid background in machine control and programming. So it has a very steep learning curve, and it took me quite a while to master it, especially because the documentation is not that great. But once I got it figured out, it's really cool, and you can control up to 8 axes with it. Now, one of the nice things is that it has dedicated parameters for setting not only velocities but also first and second order acceleration, which allow for fast and smooth movements. As a main power supply for the electronics, I used a 24-volt DC power supply, which can directly power the servo controllers. And in addition, I needed various other voltages, for example, for the piezo driver, which requires 15 volts, and for the Arduino that runs at 9 volts. Now, instead of adding more power supplies for each voltage, I made these voltages from the 24 volt by using DC to DC buck converters. And they cost around $2 on eBay. You can just set the output voltages by using a potentiometer. And also, they can deliver up to 3 amps apiece, which is more than sufficient here. I used the outputs of the KFLOP card in step direction mode. So in step direction, you use two lines. One outputs the pulses, which represent steps taken by the servo, and the other line determines the direction in which the step should be taken. So in this example, the servo will first take 2 steps in one direction and then 3 steps in the other direction. And because the servo controller and the servo motor operate in closed loop, this method is very reliable. The lead shine easy servo drivers that I use for X and Y have step direction inputs, so connecting them to the KFLOP is very easy. However, driving the piezo controller for the Z direction with step direction is actually a bit more difficult, because the piezo requires an analog voltage between 0 and 10 volts for setting the position. Now, the way I got around this was by inserting an Arduino Due, and I programmed it in such a way that one of the digital inputs accept the step pulses and another one the direction signal. Now these two input signals are used by the software in the Arduino to either increase or decrease the analog output value of one of the digital to analog converters by 1 bit. The Arduino Due has a maximum resolution of 12 bits, so you actually have a total range of over 4000 steps in the analog output voltage. However, the output range of the digital-to-analog conversion is only around 2.2 volts. So this means that you can only use approximately 20% of the total range of the piezo controller. But this is actually not a problem, because the travel range is still approximately 50 microns, which is more than sufficient for the focusing of the microscope objective. So when I tested this configuration, there was another somewhat unexpected issue. It turned out that the KFLOP can only generate negative step pulses of around 2.5 microseconds, which is too short for an Arduino to detect accurately. To get around this, I used a simple IC that can convert the very short negative pulses to much longer positive pulses, which the Arduino can then easily detect. So I mounted this timer IC on a development board, which is on top of the Arduino, as is shown here. Because the Arduino has a ton of outputs, I used three of them to display the status of the digital to analog converters and to warn if the value of the analog voltage is going out of range. Now, the last thing I had to take care of is to switch the UV light source on and off. And the violet LED draws about 1 amp, so you cannot directly use the KFLOP I/O ports. And what I did was amplify the port signal by using a high power MOSFET using the schematic shown here. Okay, so much for the electronics. Let's quickly move on to the software. Now, I made the wafer stepper software using a free version of Microsoft Visual Studio. And I don't want to go into the software architecture here, but instead I like to focus on the various concepts used in the interface. So this is the Visual Studio environment, and I've already loaded the program, so let's just start it up. Now, if we look at the main screen of the program, there's basically three areas. One that shows various machine aspects, such as the status of the KFLOP connection and the loading status of the configuration files. Now, in the second part, you can set up and test the exposure screen and the manual control screen. And in the bottom part, you can start and pause or stop execution of an exposure job. So let's start in the top screen. And I can't go over everything here, but I'll pick out some of the most important features. Let's start with the machine configuration, and this holds all the machine settings. For example, for a specific axis, it holds the name, the communication channel, the resolution in nanometers per step, the speed, the acceleration parameters, jog speed. So basically everything related to the physical properties of an axis. And the parameters can be set individually for each axis. Now let's quickly go over to the pixel field tab. And here you can set everything related to the projector and the optical properties of the projections, such as the native projector resolution and the pixel dimension, etc. And we need these data in order to relate the axis movements to the optical properties. Apart from the machine configuration, we can also define a job configuration. And this defines what's going to happen if I press the start button. And I actually defined four different types of jobs. So the first one is the expose and step job, which is the basic exposure mode. So you just expose one specific image repeatedly while changing the X and Y coordinates with each exposure. The second option presented here is the multi-image job, which basically uses all the images present in a specific folder. Now, if we look at the contents of the folder, we see that it contains the individual images as sort of a jigsaw puzzle. And when stitched together correctly, they will create one bigger image. The image names actually consist of the exposure coordinates and the relative nominal exposure energy. So the program uses this info to expose each individual image in exactly the right location with the right exposure dose. There are two more job options left, which are the exposure time range and the focus range. So basically, these are variations of the expose and step method. Now, in the exposure time mode, the exposure dose is automatically varied over a specific range. And in the focus range option, the Z coordinates are scanned over a specific number of steps. And in this way, you can quickly optimize the exposure energy and focus, especially because you can add the parameters in a text area to the exposures, so you can easily relate a specific exposure to the parameters. So I will set the job type to multi-image exposure for now. Okay, let's go to the second part of the main screen. And let's open the machine control screen, where you can see the movements of the axis and actually manually control everything. Now, as you can see, I only use 3 axes out of the 8. But let's say I want to add one more axis to control a new part of the machine. So basically, the only thing I have to do is just fill in the physical values for this axis and then click is used, and there we go. It's completely operational and we can control this new axis. Now, of course, we need to hook up the car to the new servo driver as well, but I made it very easy to configure. The manual control screen can show you the positions in steps or alternatively in millimeters with 6-digit precision, but of course, the physical reality is that you can only use the servo step as the smallest unit of motion. So if I specify the y-axis to go to 0.9 millimeters exactly, it cannot do that because there are steps of 158 nanometers. But it will get you to the step position closest to this value. So let's have a brief look at the exposure screen. Now the way this is set up is that you open an exposure window and move it to the second screen, which is in this case the beamer. And then you maximize it by clicking this button to maximize it on the projector screen. Now you cannot see the second screen here, so what I'll do is just demonstrate it on this screen and show you a part of the exposure screen. So with everything set up, the only thing you need to do is press the start button. And this will start to run the multi-image job that we have just selected. So if you watch the control screen, you see that the stage moves to a specific location and then will display the corresponding images in the exposure screen. And as you can see here, it also switches on the 405 nanometer LED during display of the image to perform the actual exposure. So basically, that's it for this video. And I can imagine that you might have additional questions. So don't hesitate to ask them in the comment section. Dag!